What is up? And happy Man Weekend, Church by the Glades. We started this thing several years ago. I always seem to be driving out in some vehicle on Man Weekend. I'm not sure why anymore. It's just kind of fun and silly. And we do a little bit of fun and silly on Man Weekend. If you want a normal week at Church by the Glades, of course, you'll be coming back next week. And we're as normal as we ever are. It's not very normal, but we all like to have fun. We should have fun in God's house. We're going to do that. If you are a newbie, my table magically appeared there. That was really cool. If you are new, welcome to CBG. Thrilled you're with us. I want to say to the ladies, we love the ladies at Church by the Glades. We love the ladies, man. You are all awesome. We have one campus in Homestead. It's an all-female campus, Homestead Correctional. Give it up for our ladies in Homestead Correctional. And I want to say to you on Man Weekend that the principles from God's Word are both powerful and pervasive, and they apply to both genders with equal power and relevance. So whether you're a guy or a girl, this is going to help you and encourage you today. But without apology, I'm tipping my hat to the men today. One more time, ladies, give a shout out to all the men. Because some men don't come to church on Father's Day week. They stay home, they sleep in, they play golf. Dull dudes, in my opinion. You have led your families to the house of God. I'm proud of you guys. Thank you for being here and manning up on this weekend. We're going to have fun. So let's jump right into it. So here's the question to begin the conversation. All of our 6 campuses, if you're watching on TV, watching online, here's the question. Don't spiritualize this question. When you think of the man, when you think of the man or a hero, who comes to mind? Now, stop. I know we're in church, and you want to say, Jesus. The right answer is probably Jesus, because 9 times you ask a question in church, the right answer is Jesus, and that would be correct, and Jesus would be the ultimate man. The Bible teaches he was fully man and fully God, and he is the ultimate example of a man. But I want to be way more superficial than that. So I mean, when I say, who's the man, I want you to think like Hollywood. I want you to think like Hollywood movie, action movie, car chases, blowing stuff up. Who is the man? In fact, I'll give you some ideas, some possible selections who the man might be. Like, let's start out maybe the man is Dwayne The Rock Johnson. Oh, yeah. That brother has so much charisma. Man, I love him and everything he does. By the way, he played defensive line for the U back in the day. Love The Rock. How about another option for the man? Another option for the man, Denzel Washington. Oh, my God. Denzel, for decades. His movies are always phenomenal. Glory, Training Day, Man on Fire, Book of Eli. I love everything Denzel does. How about somebody more current? My kids suggested John Cena. John Cena. Not much love for John. Sorry, John, if you're watching online. Another wrestler turned actor. Who else? Let me give you another choice. How about this one? Bond. All the actors who played James Bond really well. So I don't mean Roger Moore, Timothy Dalton. I mean like Sean Connery.
Sean Connery. James Bond, 007. Sean Connery.
Or Daniel Craig, the guy, oh my gosh, in the latest movies, he's done a phenomenal job, Daniel Craig. So take a moment, prayerfully ponder this deep theological question. Who is the man? Who is the man? Maybe you have your own choice. All campuses, when I shout 3, you shout out the name of who is the man. Who is the man? Ready? 1, 2, 3. Now, if you did not say Denzel Washington, you are wrong, because Denzel's the man. Denzel, I know that's subjective, it's just my opinion, but man, is he not fabulous and cool in every movie he makes? He's a good family guy. I think he's a good guy in real life. I mean, he's awesome. So I don't know who you picked. I'd probably pick Denzel Washington. If I had to pick a runner-up, I'm going with Bond, because Bond, you know, Ian Fleming's character, especially played by Sean Connery, Daniel Craig, man, Bond is not just courageous, intrepid, ruthless, resourceful, all in for king and country. He has style. Bond's a man with style. His hair, stylish. His clothing, stylish. His watch, stylish. His ride, stylish. Man, I rode on stage today in an Aston Martin. This is a world-class sports car. And in most Bond movies, the Aston Martin is James Bond's car of choice. He drives a number of high-end rides, but this is the one, whether it's a vintage model or a current model, he drives the Aston Martin. And I love me a Bond movie. My two favorites of all time, Skyfall is my number one, and just behind that, Casino Royale. Both Daniel Craig. I think Daniel Craig's done a great job with that role. And as they cast him, it was kind of controversial. Some people didn't think he had a resume to be Bond, but man, he's done a great job, in my opinion. And I can't help myself. If I'm flipping through the channels, guys, and I hit one of those two movies, I gotta stop. I've seen him a bunch of times. And so literally this last week, I'm going through the channels, and all of a sudden, there's Casino Royale. And it's kind of like 5 minutes into the movie, and I thought, you know, I'll watch it 10, 15 minutes. I know how it ends up. And so I watch it for 2 hours. And there was a scene, and I've seen it a half dozen times. There was a scene I saw. When I saw it, it confused me. When I saw this scene, it didn't feel very Bondish. There was something in this scene, in my opinion, that was inconsistent, incongruent with Bond and Bond's style. In fact, to see if it strikes you the same way, I have the scene. Let me show you just like a 30-second clip from Casino Royale, and you tell me if there's part of the scene that doesn't feel very James Bond.
Good day, sir, and welcome to the Ocean Club.
Now, Bond has all the Bond style going, the hair, the clothes, the watch. But what about that scene does not feel very James Bond? The car. He's not driving the Aston Martin. He's driving a Ford four-door sedan. Now, if you're a Ford driver, I'm not hating on you, but in my opinion, it's not very Bond. I did a little research. He's driving a car called the Ford Mondeo. They don't even make it in the States. They make it in the UK. The Ford Mondeo is this ugly little four-door. It looks like a Ford Taurus, and a Ford Fiesta had an ugly baby. And what I love about this scene is here's Daniel Craig with all his Bond coolness, the theme music playing, driving this little four-door Ford, and it just seems, and I know I'm being superficial, but it seems just inconsistent. It doesn't seem to fit. I mean, the hero doesn't feel like a hero when he steps out of the Ford Mondeo. Now, I'm not talking about cars right now, but there's some men in the room, you don't feel like the man. You don't feel like the hero because your circumstances are limited. And because your circumstances or environments are limited, you don't have an appropriate value of who you are, and you underestimate your potential. Because you do life in a Ford Mondeo, you think your potential is small, and you think you're not the man. And I'm not talking about your car at all. There's some brother going, hey, baby, I think the preacher wants me to get a better ride. No, not talking about your car. But I'm talking about the things around you. If they are reductionary or limited, they will define you. And you will see your personal potential as small and not God-sized. The man doesn't feel like the man. The woman doesn't feel like the woman. The hero doesn't feel like the hero when they step out of a Ford Mondeo. Let me show you an example of this from the Bible. I want to show you a hero, and this hero is going to rock his generation. He's going to change the direction of a nation. He's going to dispatch an evil people group oppressing God's people. He's a freedom fighter. He is bad. He is courageous. He has all kinds of leadership gifting, but he has no idea that he's the man because his circumstances and environments are limited. And again, if your circumstance is limited, you will have a diminished view of yourself and underestimate your God-given potential. His name is Gideon. His name is Gideon. When I say three, all campuses shout the name Gideon. Ready? One, two, three. Gideon. By the way, no one voted for Gideon as the man But I'm telling you, he's the man. He's a wonderful hero. Watch what happens in Gideon's story. It's found in the book of Judges. So if you have your Bible, turn to the book of Judges. We'll jump right into the narrative. His story shows up in chapters 6, 7, and 8. Read chapter 6 for homework this week, if you will. Read the whole thing, if you want to. But chapter 6, we'll see what's taking place. By the way, context, the time of the judges is a transitional period in Israel. It's between the iconic leadership of heroes like Moses and Joshua, and just before the time of the kings, heroes like David and Solomon. And it's this time when the tribes of Israel are a loose confederation of states, and God raises up these leaders called judges. Now, when you and I think of judge, you think someone you meet in a courtroom with a gavel and a black robe who renders out legal decisions. A judge in the Bible was much more than that. They had authority over the legal and judicial, but they were military leaders. They were charismatic individuals, men and at least one woman, who God would raise up to lead Israel to victory. Chapter 6, verse 1 on the screen right now. And by the way, at all campuses, I've highlighted just one word. It's the first word, so I say three. Read the one word loudly. Here we go. Ready? 1, 2, 3, again. Again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord, and for 7 years, he gave them into the hands of the Midianites. Again, what's happened again? Well, the time of the judges is one of the most dysfunctional times in the history of God's people. The people of God make the same mistake over and over. Rather than being loyal to God, faithful to God, they drift into paganism. They're seduced by the pagan cultures around them. They start to worship idols. And when God does that, if you want to lock God out of your life, you want to stiff-arm God, God will respect your free will and autonomy. You say, God, I want to do this part of my life without you. God will say, great, fine. Good luck with that. And God will take off his hand of blessing. He'll remove his hand of protection. You do life on your own. After a while, life gets hard. That's what's happened here. Not one time, but this cycles, this dysfunction of sin and rebellion cycles over and over. And I read the time of the judges, I read the book of Judges, and I look at the Israelites and go, oh, what a bunch of knuckleheads, man. Can you believe these people making the same mistake, the very same mistake, over and over, again and again. And then I look at the guy in the mirror. Anybody here ever made a really big, stupid mistake more than once? Like a dozen times or more, and when you make that mistake, you're thinking, how in the world could I be that stupid and make that same mistake again and again and again? We're just like those people. And here's the thing. God gets tired of it. God gets sick of you. God says, fine, okay, you've messed up now 27 times. I'm out. No. When you come back to God, God always comes back to you. Look what happens here. This is so bad, but watch what happens. We'll pick it up quickly. Verse 2. Because the power of Midian was so oppressive, the Israelites prepared shelters for themselves in mountain cliffs and caves and strongholds. Whenever the Israelites planted their crops, the Midianites, Amalekites, and other eastern peoples, all these warlords, invaded the country. They camped on the land, and they ruined the crops all the way to Gaza. They did not spare a living thing for Israel, neither sheep nor cattle nor donkeys. They came up with their livestock in their tents like a swarm of locusts. It was impossible to count the men and their camels. They invaded the land to ravage it. Midian so impoverished the Israelites, they cried out to the Lord for help. Smart thing to do. When your life is busted and broken, dysfunctional, run to God. Run to God. Oh, I can't run to God. I messed up so bad. God knows the mess I made. I can't. Run to God. But I've made the same mistake 137 times. God will forgive you 137 times. And receive you back. And so they come back to God. They're broken, and God is merciful, and God is compassionate, and God is patient. And look at verse 11. Here's what God does in response to their repentance. Verse 11. So on the screen at every campus right now, what happens? He sends an angel. It says, the angel of the Lord came down and sat under the oak in Ophrah. Ophrah. That woman's everywhere. Oprah. Now, Ophrah. That belonged to Joash the Abiezrite, where his son Gideon, our hero, where Gideon was threshing wheat in a wine press to keep it from the Midian. So he's threshing wheat in a wine press. I just underline that because I don't think that's the original purpose of a wine press. I would guess you make wine in a wine press. wine press is like a small, limited container, you know, and people get in there and like trod on the grapes and squeeze out the juice, and they collect the juice, and they ferment the juice, and they make wine. They make wine. So it's very effective for that purpose, but Gideon's not making wine. He's threshing wheat. Threshing wheat's very ancient. We do it today. Back in the day, the technology was simplistic. You somehow crush the any kind of grain kernel, and then you would you'd throw it in the air because the parts you cannot eat, not digestible, blow away. It's called the chaff. And the part you can eat, you buy like at Whole Foods, multigrain. Okay, that falls to the ground. So you want a place with lots of wind. In Israel, the best place is a mountaintop. But because the Midianites, he can't be on the mountaintop. So he's in a wine press. He's in a limited place, a cramped environment. Ineffective for his purposes, but at least the boy's doing something. He doesn't give up. He doesn't take a knee. It's not his family starving, so he's trying to make something happen. God bless you if you're trying to make something happen. If you're working hard, banging your head against the wall, I'll wait for it. Thank you at least, because God calls people who are busy doing something. But he's doing something that's not effective. Why? The environment is ill-suited for his purposes. The environment is reductionary and limited. He's in a small place, and you're going to see he has a small view of who he is. Now, my Bible, verse 11, is followed by verse 12. Followed by what? Verse 12. It's on the screen right now. Here's what the angel says. The angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon. He said, "The Lord is with you, mighty." I want all the men to read that with me. Ready? "The Lord is with you, mighty." God is calling you my brother to be. God in God's word, my man. He's calling you to be a lover. A lover. You've read your Bible, right? I mean, we're called to love people all the time. Amen? You've read the New Testament? Come on, bros. You've read, man, we're called to love. We're called to love God, number one. When Jesus was asked, what is the greatest commandment? Jesus said, love God. Now, don't love God with just a little slice of your Sunday. Love God with all you have. Love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. All the men loudly said, amen. Come on, men, loudly said, amen. And then what do you do next? Jesus said, well, love your neighbor as yourself. Hope you have nice neighbors. I love my neighbor. All right. Who else should we love? Well, the Bible teaches we should love as men the church of Jesus Christ. Why? The church is esteemed. Jesus calls the church his bride. He calls the church his body. And we're to love the bride of Christ. God bless you men for bringing your families to the house of God, engaging in the house of God, serving the bride of Christ, loving the bride of Christ. Who else are we called to love? Kids. If you're a dad, man, we're called to love our kids, provide for our kids, encourage and champion our kids, when needed, appropriately to correct and discipline our kids. Who else are we called to love? That awesome, beautiful woman that God has given you as your wife. And all the ladies loudly said, come on, ladies, yeah. Husbands, we're called to love our wives. Okay, well, how much? Is there a standard provided? Yeah, how about Ephesians chapter 5, verse 28. Here's the standard. It says, husbands, love your wives the way that Christ loved the church. Whoa, that's a high bar. That's wow. I mean, he's like perfect. I'm not perfect. That's wow. That's a lot. Is there any place of standards to find a little more clarity? Okay, I can drop down to verse 28, same chapter. It says, husbands, love and to be devoted to your wife the way you love and care for your own body. And some brothers think, well, look in the mirror, man. I don't think much of my body. So I look at my body, I can do that. No. Not like that. Not whether you find your body attractive or in shape or what. No, your physique. No, it means the way you're always attentive, my brother, to your body needs. Because I don't know a man who's not highly attentive to body needs, right? Your body. You're hungry, my brother. What do? You feed that body. When your body is tired, you give that body rest. When that body is thirsty, you get that body something to drink, right? Even when that body itches, you hope she's not looking, but you scratch it, right? Right? We just do that. We're always very attentive to our body needs. It comes very naturally. In the same way, we should be just as devoted to her needs. We're even called to love our enemies if we can. We're called to be lovers. We're called to be lovers. As men of God, we're called to be loving. Now, I think the church does a pretty good job with that message. what doesn't get pressed in the churches, we're called to be lovers and fighters. The Lord is with you, mighty warrior. We're called to be fighters. Let me tell you what I don't mean. I don't mean we're called to be violent. We're not called to be bullies. We're not called to be argumentative. We're not called to be pugnacious. But we are called to fight. David, fight for what? Fight for the faith. Fight for fidelity. Fight for our families. Fight for our children. Fight for the kingdom of God to advance his church. Jesus said this about the church. He said the kingdom of God is aggressively moving forward and powerful men take hold of it. We are called to be lovers and called to be fighters. The Lord is with you, mighty warrior. So here Gideon, who's lived this marginalized life, his whole life oppressed by Midianites and Eastern raiders. He's trying to, you know, thresh wheat in a wine press. It's small and ineffective and reductionary. And God speaks words of vision into his life. How does he receive that word? No doubt like a hero movie made by Marvel, where the superhero finds his or her superpower and charges off to save people and do the mission. No. Verse 13, here's how he responds to what God has clearly called him to do. But sir, he has good manners. But sir, Mr. Angel, Gideon replied, if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? Where are the wonders that our fathers told us about when they said, did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt? Look at this carefully. It's not highlighted. But now, right, here's, I get it. You're calling me to be a warrior and save Israel. But I didn't highlight the word but. When I say three, say the word but. One, two, three. But, all right, listen, huge principle. God is speaking to him, angel, audibly. Clarity. God speaks to us scripturally, right? When God speaks in this book, and sometimes you're in church or you're reading the Bible, and God says something about your life, we need to make a change or step up, and you recognize what God says is really crystal, it's really clear, and it's applicable to you, and you say, oh, okay, God, I understand that. Here's what the Bible is saying, but, right? You make an excuse or you give a qualifier or something. But, hey, God, I know what you're telling me to do. Pastor David said this thing, and wow, that really resonates in my heart. But, blah, blah, blah. But, dot, 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 right? But, just know, whatever you say after the but is wrong. Whatever you give to God, when God has spoken, and you say, God, I get it. Okay, I'll do it. Maybe, but, blah, 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 blah. Whatever you say after the but is wrong and will mess you up. Because God's spoken. Who knows truth? God. Who never gets it wrong? God. Who knows you better than you know yourself? God. Who loves you more than you love yourself? God. Who knows all data, information, past, present, and future? God. And God has spoken, but you give God your but. Don't show God your butt when God speaks. I mean, you do it all the time. Maybe somebody today, you should give your heart to Christ or be baptized or give God that habit or that relationship. Yeah, God, I really know that habit's messing me up and I know what the Bible's saying about it, but what you're about to say after the butt's going to be stupid. It's going to be bonehead. It's going to be wrong. Let me say this clear. If God speaks, don't show God your butt, because whatever you say after your butt's going to be butt stupid, butt ugly, and get your butt in trouble. Can I be that clear on Man Weekend? So here's Gideon like, oh, but sir, you call me a hero, but blah, 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 but he just gives all this stuff. Where was I? I'm on the but, you know, I can't do this because I can't. But now the Lord has abandoned us and put us in the hands of Midian. I love the response of the angel. Verse 14, the Lord turned to him and said, go in the strength that you have. Go in the strength you have and save Israel out of Midianite's hand. Am I not sending you? But, he gives God his butt a second time. Lord Gideon asked, how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family. God has spoken. You're a mighty warrior. You're going to save your people. You're going to turn the tide of this thing. You're going to beat back the haters and you're going to rescue. It's going to be awesome. Go in the strength that you have. And he says, you didn't see I drive a Ford Mondeo. You don't see I'm in a wine press. I'm barely getting by here. You don't find warriors in wine presses. I'm not the guy. There's somebody here, you're thinking you're not the man that God's going to use. Someone thinking, yeah, I'm not the woman that God could do powerful things. Because why? Your life has been so marginalized. Your environment so dysfunctional. Your relationships have limited you. You need to believe what God has said about you, not what the world says about you. This world will seek to limit you every single time, and you'll underestimate who you are and undervalue what God wants to do in your life. You don't find warriors, Gideon says, in a wine press. God said, guess what? Just found one. Now, what made Gideon think so little of his own potential? Well, here's the great theological question of the day. Who put you in the Ford Mondeo? Because that's not God's plan for your life. What were the dynamics at play that made him self-limit? I think three things are kind of obvious. Quickly, I'm going to run through all these. Number one is clear. It's the haters. It's the haters. It's these evil people, Midianites, Amalekites, Eastern Raiders, these warlords, these tribes, and they're raiding Israel. They're plundering Israel. They are ruthless. They are cruel. They are racist. They're so unrelenting. They're stupid. They're about to starve Israel out. They're like a hunter that hunts a species to extinction. Evil people. Gideon had his haters. He thinks his potential is small because the haters' power is so great. Now, listen, you're going to have haters. I don't care how much faith you have, how much you honor the Bible, how much you pray or love God, you're going to have opposition. And every time I meet a Christian who's surprised by the fact they have conflict, I think that's a Christian who's not read their Bible. Because the Bible does not just prepare us for conflict, it promises us conflict. We're going to face trials and tribulation and hardship and opposition. But guess what? No haters, no heroes. The backdrop of a hero narrative, haters, opposition. Now, our church is now being televised all around the world. And there are people right now, you're watching this in places where you're being physically persecuted for your faith. God bless you. You're in our prayers. You have it tough. In the States here, we have it relatively pretty easy. The main way we're opposed for our faith, no one's trying to arrest you or kill you. No one's going to arrest me for preaching the gospel this Sunday. Criticism. You may get criticized for your faith. You may get criticized for your witness if you're doing it right. Listen, some of us just have critical people in our lives. Maybe you have a chronically negative, critical person in your life. You're wondering, what's wrong, God? Why are these people hating on me, verbally criticizing me, always putting me down? Guess what? It's part of life. If you're being criticized by someone, you're in good company. Jesus had his critics. They ascribed his miracles to the power of Satan. Oh, he does his miracles by the power of Beelzebub. Paul had his critics. Paul, stop wasting your time on Gentiles, man. God only loves Jewish people. Those Gentiles are too messed up. Nehemiah, critics. Why are you trying to build that wall? Man, Jerusalem's a decimated second-rate city. Don't even bother. It will never happen. Moses pastored a congregation of 2 million whiners. Read the book of Exodus. They complain about every leadership move Moses makes, and he was Moses, miracle worker, spoke to God face to face. They whine, Moses, the promised land's too far. Moses, freedom's too tough. Moses, let's go back to Egypt. You listen to chronically critical people, they will take you back to Egypt every single time. You listen to what God says about you. Critics. I'll wait for it. Man, I get it. Look, my goal is I'm a pastor. I'm trying to advance the kingdom. I'm trying to win people to Jesus. I'm far from perfect, but I have integrity. And I get people criticize me all the time. It's a matter of numbers. I mean, there's 9 to 10,000 people actually show up at Church by the Glaze on a normal weekend. Big weekends, we get 20,000 people. Ever try to make 20,000 people happy? So know what I do? Okay, listen, you need feedback. Hear me. You need feedback. You need constructive criticism to get better. You need coaching to get better. You need trainers to get better. You need that, right? But be careful who you allow to speak into your life in that kind of way. Because some people are just negative and hateful and critical. Some are constructive. So me personally, as a pastor and as a man, as a husband, as a father, who do I allow to critique me and give constructive criticism? It's a short list. I allow people who love me, people who believe in me, people who know more than I know. That's a pretty big list right there. And if I'm trying to get somewhere, someone who's already been there and will share their map. I'll let those people correct my course all day long. But just random, critical people, no. In fact, pastor in this church, you talk about criticism. Do you know how many critical emails I have received in the last 10 years? You know how many? I don't know either. I never read them. Not a one. If you don't like something, you can email me at Church by the Glades. I don't know, someone reads it, it's not me. Because like 10 years ago, I thought, I can't read these anymore. I'm trying to serve God. I'm trying to be faithful. People are ripping me and criticizing me. And I'm second guessing. And get vision's too fragile for that. So I thought, you know, God, if I can spend the day and I please you, and if I please Lisa, that's a good day. I'll take that. Now, listen, accountability and feedback from the right people, vital. You got to have that. So I have colleagues, and I have peers, and I have people. They hold me accountable. They speak into my life. They correct me. That's just wisdom right there. But make sure you're careful who you open that up to. Critical people. So he had his haters, the Midianites, haters. But worse than that, his own neighbors. So you read chapter 6 for homework, and he's going to listen to God. He's overwhelmed, but he's going to obey God. Gideon is. And he's going to do the first thing God clearly, audibly commands him to do. He's going to do this thing and to lead the people back to God. And his neighbors wake up the next morning, and they see this thing that God commanded Gideon to do, and he obeys God. And what do? They say, oh, Gideon, thank you so much. We didn't realize how apostate we were and how we're coming back now. Thank you for leading. No, they want to kill him. And critical people will kill you. Metaphorically, they'll kill your vision. They can't listen to them. Warriors. What? Hey, did you notice there was like a few basketball games this last week? Anybody notice a little basketball game? Basketball's over. Woo! In my opinion, man, great matchup. Best team in the East, Cavaliers. You know, LeBron, Kyrie Irving, Kevin Love, a great team. But the other team, what was their name? Warriors. The Warriors. Golden State Warriors. One of the best teams in decades. Probably 4 legitimate Hall of Famers on that team, 2 MVPs. Kevin Durant was on fire during that series. Man, the Warriors were so good. But my favorite player on the Warriors actually is probably Steph Curry. I love Steph Curry. That guy has ball skills. That guy, if he gets across the midcourt line, he's in range for a 3. He's so very, very good. But when Steph Curry came out of Tiny Davis in college, the reviews on him, the scouting reports were very, very mixed. There were lots of scouts thought he would not make it in the league. In fact, here's some actual criticisms that scouts made of Steph Curry back in 2009. They said he was too small, 6'3", 185 pounds. That's small for NBA. It says his explosiveness and athleticism are below standard. One said he's not a great finisher around the basket. This one makes me laugh. One said he needs to considerably improve as a ball handler. No one's dribbled better, including the Harlem Globetrotters, than this guy. Often struggles against physical defenders. Must develop as a point guard to make it in the league. Look at this. Will have limited success at the next level. Do not rely on him to run your team. That's Steph Curry, world champion 2015, world champion 2017, MVP 2015, MVP of the league 2016. Don't listen to the critics. Listen to God. Had his haters. Quickly. Circumstances. It was a time when the circumstances were difficult. The circumstances to transition the nation far from ideal. The Midianites and the Amalekites had them outnumbered, outmanned, outgunned. It was not going to be a fair fight. And he actually picked up some of this rhetoric in verse 13 that in his protests, as he's asking God some questions, you see he's saying it's really not a good time. Verse 13 is on the screen right now. He says, Mr. Angel, where are all God's wonders that our fathers told us about back during the Exodus? Where are all those miracles and those plagues? He's basically saying, look, I get it. Someone needs to step up and be the man, be the hero. But it was easier back in the day. Back in the day, oh my God, it was easier back during Moses and the miracles. It's tough now. Now's hard. Back in the day. Look, I can wax nostalgic. I can look back at things. Yesteryear, I mentioned Sean Connery, man. I can do that. But I get so sick and tired of back in the day Christians. I get tired of back in the day people. Y'all know I like to fish, man. I fish the Florida Keys. But if I have a fishing guide who's over 50 years old, they'll give me, man, back in the day. Those tarpon were so easy to catch back in the day. The bonefish were everywhere. Oh, you should have seen back in the day. And I think to myself, it's like, yeah, I'm sure it's true. But I'm fishing now. I want to catch me something now. All I got me is some now. You keep your back in the day. I'm seasoned now. This is the moment God has. There was a big meeting in Phoenix this last week, a bunch of pastors and colleagues in our network, and they got together. I didn't go because I've been to these things before, and these guys get together, and all they do is talk about back in the day. Oh, back in the 70s, it was easier to build the church. Back in the 80s, people thought more about churches. People don't even think about church or God. I'm trying to advance the kingdom of God right now. I'm living right now. I'm leading right now. See, some men live in the past. Other men live in the future. No, someday when all my ducks are in a row, someday when all the stars align, someday in the future. Man, my brother, all you have is right now. Seize the moment right now. But the conditions, the environments, the pushback, oh, it's not good right now. It is always a problem. Look what it says in Ecclesiastes chapter 11, verse 4. And by the way, God brought some person, some procrastinator, or some back-in-the-day guy to church just to smack you upside your head with this verse. This verse is money. It says right now, it's on the screen, if you wait for perfect conditions, you will never get anything done. Now, grab you some now. Grab me some now. Turn to your neighbor, don't grab them now, but tell them to grab some now. Turn to your neighbor and say, grab you some now. Grab you some now. How about this? Listen, I want to get right up in somebody's grill in a nice way. There's somebody here, and you've been coming to church for a few weeks, and you felt the Holy Spirit kind of tugging at your heart, and you need, at the end of the service, to be nice people at the edge of every stage, every campus, their prayer partners. And you've been feeling this need to come forward and give your heart to Christ. But, been showing God your butt, but you're like, I'm not ready yet. I got questions. I got issues. I got messy. I'm not, oh, David, yeah. I'll probably like in a month or a year, I'll be ready. I'm not ready now. Oh no, do it today. Right now, today. Get baptized today. But my clothes, we got clothes. We'll baptize you in our clothes. Now. Now's not a good time. Oh, now's the right time. In fact, now is the perfect time for you to nail this down and give your heart to Christ and punch your ticket for heaven now. And you're thinking, look, you're clapping. People have already done clapping. Somebody out there looking at me like, you don't know me. You don't know my circumstance. You're saying now. How can you be so assumptive to say now is the time? I don't know you. No, you're right. I don't know you. You know you better than I know you. But God knows you better than you know you. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 2. God says, guess what the time is? Won't you be saved? Won't you read this with me? I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. See, you don't think you're ready, but God thinks you're ready. In fact, God inspired the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit inspired the Apostle Paul to write this passage 2,000 years ago, knowing that you'd be sitting in a church by the Glades campus, and he'd come right upside your reality with this verse. And God says, you're more ready than you know, so make the move now. It's not someday in the past. Now is your time. Third and finally, excuses. Excuses. As you read the narrative, sometimes my man, my brother, the first man warrior you must defeat every day is the man you meet in the mirror. Because your life has so limited you, your environments have so reduced you, you don't believe what God says about you. And so, you know, as Gideon comes up with all these excuses, Lord, my clan's a small clan, my tribe's Manasseh, not very important, and, you know, my family's a little bitty family, you got the wrong guy. You don't find warriors in wine presses. You see, I got a Ford Mondeo in the driveway. I'm not your guy. And I love God's response in verse 14. In verse 14, God just says, guess what? Go in the strength that you have. Go, let me break that down. Because a lot of us say, yeah, I'll go someday, God. Well, I get more strength. I get more stuff. Have more experience. More influence. Someday, God, when all these things, someday when I graduate, God, I'm going to go. Someday when I get married, I'm going to settle down, plug into the church, me and the missus, but right now I'm a single, I'm having fun. Okay, we're married, it's kind of crazy, and we have kids, we're going to raise the kids in the church, surely. Oh, we got kids, and it's so crazy busy. When the kids leave someday, praise Jesus, I hope they leave, then I'll. It's always something that's not right, something's holding you back, some excuse. I've had people say, hey, preacher, when I win the lottery, I'm going to start tithing. Like God cares about zeros? He cares about faithfulness. Go in the strength that you have. See, everything in Gideon's world told him he was small. Everything told him he wasn't the man. He had to choose who to believe. But God sent a messenger to say, the Lord is with you. Mighty warrior, go in the strength that you have. Save your people. Make a mark in this generation. Be a warrior. Make a difference. Go now. So there's something in your life that's weird, not right. Just make it work. It's not those things around you that define you. So I was thinking about Daniel Craig. Daniel Craig, first movie he plays, James Bond, iconic James Bond, Casino Royale. The day he walks on set to shoot that scene in the Bahamas, and they hand him the keys, not to an Aston Martin or Ferrari, they hand him, and a lot of people are criticizing the choice of Daniel Craig. Can't he pull off James Bond? And they give the actor the keys to a Ford Mondeo. What I love about that scene is Daniel Craig doesn't blink. He gets in that car, he drives that punk four-door car with all the swag of Bond, with all the coolness of Bond. He gets out at the Ocean Club, most expensive hotel in Nassau, and he throws the valet the keys like he threw him the keys to this high-end car. Guess what? He recognized it's not the car that makes the man. He's the man. He's going to play the character. He's going to be the man. He's going to be Bond. So it's not your car. It's not your job. It's not your bank account. It's not your issues, it's your problem. It's the call of God on your life. And God says, you are the man. You are the woman. You need to stand up right now and lead and take some turf and make a difference. Go in the strength that you have. Go in the strength that you have right now and live for your King. Father God, I pray people make some decisions. We've had a lot of fun. We've been kind of silly. We shot Heather in the foot today. It's been great here at this campus. You know, it's just been fun. But though we have fun, the decisions we make are deadly serious. Someone's going to decide, just walk home and shake this off, forget about this word that you've placed in their spirit. But someone else is going to rise up and believe they are bigger than their environments, that their potential is greater than their circumstances, that God Almighty has declared that she is the woman. Or he is the man. And it's time to be heroic and serve the living God with power and faith. So, Father, we embrace your destiny. We love you. We make this prayer in Jesus' name.